Hey guys, welcome back. So today we'll be discussing about another important topic, that is development of occlusion. So before moving on ahead, if you have not subscribed my channel, please like, share and subscribe my channel Akshay Bhandari's Dental Videos to get more such content. So let's move ahead. So periods of occlusal development has been divided into four stages. First is pre-dentition period, followed by the deciduous dentition period, followed by the mixed dentition period, and finally the permanent dentition period. Moving on to stage 1, pre-dentition period, from 0 to 6 months, which is usually identified by the presence of gum pads. So as we adults have maxillary and mandibular ridges, similarly alveolar arches of an infant at the time of birth are called as gum pads. So let's see part of gum pads in detail. Firstly, there is an incisive papilla. From this incisive papilla, there appears groove which travels backwards, which is called as dental groove. It separates the labial and lingual half of the pads. Then there is transverse groove which separates the gum pad into 10 segments, and each segment it develops into one tooth. So in all, per arch we get 10 teeth. Then there is lateral sulcus, which is the transverse groove between the canine and the deciduous first molar. And lastly, the gingival groove, which separates the gum pad from the palate. The shape of the maxillary gum pad, it is usually horseshoe shaped and it is larger than that of mandibular gum pad, which is U-shaped and rectangular. Now moving on to relationship of maxillary and mandibular gum pads. Now firstly, talking about the maxilla. Maxilla is larger and prominent, and hence it usually shows class 2 jaw relation in gum pads, whereas maxilla is also larger and wider than mandible, hence it also shows complete overjet. Now focusing in the first molar area, the gum pads maxillary and mandibular, they contact in the first molar area, because of which there is an anterior open bite, and through this anterior open bite usually the tongue protrudes. But this closes once the primary teeth erupts, hence it forms a self-correcting anomaly. Now in all, if we summarize the features, it can be complete overjet as maxilla is larger and wider than mandible, then class 2 jaw relation because the maxilla is larger and prominent, then third is anterior open bite because the maxillary and mandibular gum pads, they contact in the first molar area, because of which there is an anterior open bite present, and through this anterior open bite the tongue protrudes. Moving on to stage 2, that is deciduous dentition, from 6 months to 6 years. It starts from the eruption of first deciduous teeth, that is usually deciduous mandibular central incisors, and it ends with the eruption of first permanent molar, that is first permanent teeth. So what are the features of the deciduous dentition? First of all, there is vertical inclination of the anteriors. As we can see in permanent dentition, the incisors, the maxillary incisors, they are slightly labially inclined. But in case of deciduous dentition, the incisors, or in general the anteriors, they are vertically inclined. So because of which there is shallow overjet and overbite. And also there is spacing present in the anterior teeth. Next, simian or anthropoid or primate spaces. So these are the spaces which are present mesial to maxillary canine and distal to mandibular canine. Just concentrate on the figure. There is space which is present mesial to maxillary canine, and there is space which is present distal to mandibular canine. So these spaces are called as simian or anthropoid or primate spaces. So this space, it is utilized for early mesial shift. And third is the terminal plane. So terminal plane, it is the mesiodistal relation between the distal surfaces of upper and lower deciduous second molar. So this terminal plane has been divided into three types. First type is flush terminal plane, second is mesial terminal plane, and third is distal terminal plane. So each type has been discussed with respect to mandibular second molar. In flush terminal plane, the distal surface of both upper and lower deciduous second molar are in same vertical plane, as been shown by the arrow. Secondly, in mesial terminal plane, the distal surface of mandibular second molar is mesial to the distal surface of the maxillary decideus second molar. Whereas in distal terminal plane, the distal surface of mandibular decideus second molar is distal to the distal surface of maxillary decideus second molar. So in general, as the name suggests, in flush terminal plane, flush is at the same level. So the distal surface of both maxillary and mandibular second molar are at the same plane. Whereas in mesial terminal plane, the mandibular second molar, it is slightly mesial to the maxillary second molar. Whereas in distal terminal plane, the mandibular second molar, it is slightly distal to the maxillary second molar. This is in respect to decideus second molars. Please do note that. Moving ahead to stage 3, we have discussed pre-dentition period, in which we read about gum pads. Then we read about stage 2, that is decideus dentition, in which we read about their clinical features such as spacing, then vertical inclination of the anteriors with shallow overjet and overbite, then simian spaces and terminal plane. After that, we are switching on to stage 3, that is mixed dentition period, which persists from 6 to 12 years of age. So this is the period where teeth of both decideus and permanent dentition are seen. Hence it is called as mixed dentition, because we see both decideus as well as permanent teeth. It extends from 6 to 12 years of age, and most malocclusions make their appearance during this stage. This stage can be divided into two transitional periods, that is first transitional period and second transitional period. In first transitional period, the events which we see usually are emergence of first permanent molar, then transition of incisors, and initiation of ugly duckling stage. Whereas in second transitional period, what changes do we see is, firstly, there is exfoliation of primary molars and canines. Then in that place, there is eruption of permanent canines and premolars. Then there is eruption of the permanent second molars. And finally, establishment of occlusion. So in short, in first transitional period, we see changes with respect to first permanent molars and incisors. Whereas in second transitional period, we see changes from canines till the second molars. So moving on to first transitional period, the very first stage, that is eruption of first permanent molars. So we read about terminal plane in decideus dentition. So this terminal plane, whether it be flush terminal plane or mesial or distal step terminal plane, each type has the specific importance. We show that how the permanent molar is going to erupt. Now if there is flush terminal plane in the patient, this flush terminal plane, it further gives class 1 molar relationship when the permanent molars erupt. If there is mesial step terminal plane present, this mesial step terminal plane, it leads to class 1 molar relationship, or if there is an excessive growth of mandible, then it may lead to class 3 molar relationship. Whereas in case of distal step terminal plane, the permanent molar erupts in class 2 molar relationship. So each terminal plane shows the specific relationship of the permanent molars. Flush terminal plane shows class 1 molar relationship for permanent molars. Mesial step terminal plane show class 1 or class 3 molar relationship, whereas distal step shows class 2 molar relationship. Hence, whenever we see into the patient the type of terminal plane, we can judge that in what relation the permanent molar is going to erupt. If the flush terminal plane is seen, we can judge that class 1 molar relationship would be achieved in future. Then if there is mesial step terminal plane, again class 1 or class 3 if mandibular growth is excessive. And if there is distal step, we're gonna get class 2 molar relationship for permanent first molars. Moving on to next event, that is eruption of incisors. Now before, we have spoke about eruption of permanent first molars. Now there is eruption of incisors. Now in this event, there is something called as incisor liability. So just see the figure. Let's consider the combined width of maxillary permanent incisors to be B, whereas the combined width for maxillary deciduous incisors to be A. Similarly for mandibular teeth, B for mandibular permanent incisors and A for mandibular deciduous incisors. Now from the figure we can judge that B is more than A. What does this shows? That the width of the permanent incisors, both maxillary and mandibular, it is greater than those of the deciduous incisors. Now simply if we subtract B minus A, whatever value we are going to get, that value is called as an incisal liability. So incisal liability is the difference between amount of space needed and the amount of space available for the exchange of primary to permanent incisors. Liability for maxillary arch is usually 7 to 8 millimeters, whereas liability for mandibular arch is 5 to 6 mm. Now what does these values suggest? Liability for maxillary arch is 7 to 8 mm. This shows that the width of the maxillary permanent incisors, it is 7 to 8 mm greater than that of the width of maxillary deciduous incisors. Similarly, for mandibular arch, which is 5 to 6 mm, what does this signify? That the width of the deciduous incisors, it is 5 to 6 mm lesser than that of the combined width of the mandibular permanent incisors. This also has one more meaning, such that the maxillary permanent incisors, they are short of 7 to 8 mm of space to erupt, whereas mandibular permanent incisors fall short of 5 to 6 mm of space to erupt. Now how this space shortening is compensated? How these incisors, they get space to erupt? So they get space to erupt by utilizing three spaces. First is the utilization of spacing in deciduous dentition. So as we know that in deciduous dentition there is generalized spacing present. So this spacing, it is utilized by the incisors to erupt. Second, there is increase in intercanine width with age. So as the age progresses, there is broadening of the jaw. And because of this broadening of the jaw, there is increase in intercanine width. And as there is increase in intercanine width, there is again spacing occurs, and this spacing is utilized by the incisors to erupt. And thirdly, changes in the incisal angulation. As we know that in deciduous dentition, the incisors are vertically aligned, whereas in case of permanent dentition, the incisors are slightly labially inclined. So this increases the arch perimeter. So the incisal liability, it is compensated by first thing, utilization of spacing in deciduous dentition. Second thing, increasing intercanine width with age. And third is changes in incisal angulation. Moving on to Broadbent's phenomenon or ugly duckling stage. So there is an initiation of ugly duckling stage in first transitional period. So what is this phenomenon actually? So at the age of 8 years, just concentrate on the first figure. At the age of 8 years, when the permanent maxillary canines are erupting, they apply pressure over the roots of lateral and central incisors. Do follow the arrows in the figures. So whenever the maxillary canines are erupting, they apply pressure over the roots of lateral and central incisors, because of which the roots are pushed medially and there is development of midline diastema between the incisors. And as soon as the canine erupts, the pressure over the root, it transfers to the pressure over the crowns. And because of this pressure, the midline spacing, it gets self-corrected. Hence the pressure, the medial pressure which was present over the root, it transfers over the crowns of the incisors once the canine erupts. And as the pressure, it transfers over the crown, the spacing, it decreases or gets self-corrected. So this is called as Broadbent's phenomenon or ugly duckling stage. Secondly, we are done with the first transitional period of mixed dentition. Now we are switching on to second transitional period. So in second transitional period, the first event is exfoliation of primary canines and molars. And on exfoliation of this canines and molars, we get their permanent successors, like eruption of permanent canines and then eruption of the permanent premolars. Now here we come across the leeway space of NANS. In the figure we can see that the combined mesiodistal widths of deciduous canine first and second molars, it is more than that of the combined mesiodistal width of permanent canine first and second premolar. So the width of the deciduous teeth, it is more than that of the width of the permanent teeth. Hence the difference between these two is called as leeway space of NANS. So leeway space of NANS is actually a surplus space or extra space which forms because of the difference in the mesiodistal widths of deciduous and permanent teeth, whereas exact opposite thing happens in case of incisal liability. Incisal liability, in that case there is shortage of space for permanent incisors, whereas leeway space of NANS is extra space or surplus space which is present after the eruption of the permanent canine and premolars. So the amount of leeway space of NANS is in maxilla, it is 0.9 millimeters per segment. So it is 1.8 mm in total, like 0.9 into 2. Then mandible, it is 1.7 mm per segment. So for total arch, it would be 1.7 into 2, that is 3.4 millimeters in total. So for maxilla, it is 1.8 mm in total. And for mandible, it is 3.4 mm in total. Moving on to eruption of permanent second molars. So before emergence of permanent second molar, they are usually oriented in mesial and lingual direction. And because of this mesial and lingual direction, the arch length, it is reduced prior to eruption by the mesial eruptive forces. Because of these mesial eruptive forces, sometimes crowding may occur into the dentition. And once the permanent second molars erupt, there is an establishment of occlusion. This permanent second molar, they are guided into occlusion by the cone funnel mechanism, that is the upper palatal cusp, they acts as cone which slides into the lower occlusal fossa which acts as funnel. And lastly, stage 4, that is permanent dentition. The features of the permanent dentition are: the midline coincides, that is maxillary and mandibular midline coincides with each other. Then there is formation of overjet and overbite. If there is excessive jaw growth in forward direction, the overjet and overbite decreases. Then there is class 1 molar relationship which is obtained. And lastly, there is curve of spi which starts developing. So these are the four features which we usually observe in the permanent dentition. First is midline coincides. Second is overjet and overbite formation. Third, the overjet and overbite, it decreases as the jaw grows forward. Fourth, class 1 molar relationship is obtained. And fifth, curve of spi starts developing. Let's move over the quick revision. So the development of occlusion, as we have studied, there are four stages: pre-deciduous, deciduous dentition, mixed dentition and permanent dentition. So in pre-deciduous dentition, usually it is characterized by gum pads. So maxillary gum pad, it is horseshoe shaped, whereas mandibular gum pad, it is U-shaped. Then there is list of grooves and sulcus into the gum pads which are seen. That is transverse groove, dental groove, gingival groove and lateral sulcus. These grooves and sulcus, they are similarly present in both maxillary as well as mandibular gum pad. So the difference between maxillary and mandibular gum pad is just with respect to shape. Maxillary gum pad are horseshoe shaped and mandibular gum pad are U-shaped, whereas grooves and sulcus are similar for both the gum pads. Moving on to deciduous dentition, they are characterized by the presence and eruption of the deciduous teeth. So features of the deciduous dentition are spacing in the teeth, shallow overjet and overbite. Then there are primate, simian or anthropoid spaces, that is mesial to maxillary canine and distal to mandibular canine. Then there is terminal plane, in which there are three types: flush terminal plane, mesial terminal plane and distal terminal plane. Then coming on to mixed dentition, there is first transitional period and second transitional period. In first transitional period, we have events such as emergence of first permanent molars, followed by the transition of incisors, in which we read about incisor liability space. And third is the initiation of ugly duckling stage. In second transitional period, there is exfoliation of primary canines and molars, and in place of that, there is eruption of permanent canines and premolars, and also we read in that the leeway space of Nance, followed by eruption of permanent second molars, and finally the establishment of occlusion. So I hope guys you liked the video. If you liked the video, please like, share and subscribe my channel Akshay Bhandari's Dental Videos. We'll see you soon with more such content. Thank you.